All right. Hello, welcome to a special Lords and Villeins stream. I'm joined by one of the devs.
Welcome.
So, today we'll spend some time here hanging out with the dev playing Lords and Villeins. And we'll just sort of get an introduction and an overview of all the new stuff that's been here on the game. Go ahead, introduce yourself.
Hello, I'm Michal. I'm the developer behind Lords and Villeins. I'm mainly in charge of design and production, but we work together on the game also with Christian, who's responsible for programming. Also Andrea, who's been doing the art, and a beautiful music from Adam Bow. I'm very happy to be here and show you the game and talk about all the cool stuff and just have a lot of fun.
So I saw this game first. So I first played it when it hit Steam, like a Steam demo, like a year and a half ago. I remember seeing it on itch.io, one of the first. I think you put it there first, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we started with a small demo version on itch about a year ago now. I think it's a bit over a year now. Yeah,
I remember seeing it. I remember thinking, because you know, itch.io is kind of like the old west of game sites. You get some really good stuff, and you get some strange things. And then I remember seeing Villeins, and I remember thinking, who spelled Villeins wrong? What is this nonsense? And then I later learned what a villain is. It villain or Villeins? What it actually is.
I think it's Villeins.
Villeins, I think, is actually, I think it might be the proper way.
Or Villeins. I tried to use Google Translate how Google thinks it's spelled. And Google says it's Villeins, so I don't know. We might need to get some expert on this.
So good luck. Good luck finding one of those. All right, we'll hop in. Do you have a map preference you want to join in here? Jump into?
Usually, I think Swamp is very interesting to play because it has a pretty cool layout, or the seaside if you like more of a chill breeze.
My test game while was Lord Tim Tam. All right, I'll be Lord Nukuntinti will be my name. Also, anyone in chat at the moment here on YouTube or on Steam, if you have any questions, feel free to yell them out and we will do our best to answer them. I will be a, we'll sort of randomize myself here. Pick a good-looking lord. There we go. Okay. Interested in females. I noticed we can do both. Excellent. I will have, so I have a question for you initially. So we start out with our ruler, and we choose whether we have a partner or not, of course. The game tells us to have a partner, otherwise it's going to be difficult. Now, if I didn't have a partner, is marriage in it yet? Could my character go and marry one of the villagers?
Yeah, so in the recent update, we've been adding a marriage feature for peasants. So the peasants should be able to socialize and build relationships, eventually also request marriage between each other. But for the noble family, that isn't really possible yet. We're going to be adding that in the big nobleman update, which is coming next, where you will be able to request marriage with other noble families. So you will be selectively choosing who would you like to marry, and they're gonna look at it and either straight up just accept because it's an interesting arrangement, or they're gonna have a counteroffer for you.
Okay. Yeah, I noticed. So marriage isn't in the game now with your peasants.
With the peasants, they can marry. I think there's currently some bugs because people are reporting that it's not always working, but peasants should definitely be able to marry. It's just the ruling family that currently has not really a way to do that because they're not going to be interacting with peasants as much.
So there's going to be other ruling families that'll be out there in an overworld, or is this going to be sort of just like a kind of like a caravan kind of thing?
In the nobleman update, there are going to be new types of families added, which will be living in your settlement as well. And you can think of them as more of a luxurious society kind of a thing. So they're going to be more demanding. They're going to want more stuff from you. They like the high luxury stuff. You got to build nicer houses for them. And they're going to be generally more demanding and also have more freedom. So unlike peasants, they will be able to just leave if you're not doing a good job.
See, I got myself. I got a lot of people here. I noticed the new update added in more. Is that correct? The new update added in more people, more starting people.
Yeah, because we added the inn, which is a zone that you start usually start with because you want to attract new families. And now they don't just show up randomly anymore. You got to build the inn, and because you need a family to run the inn right from the start, we added one more family to start with. So you have easier time getting going with things.
I noticed.
So usually you would just decide between one of them that this family is going to be in charge of the inn.
So one of them will do like a farm and then also run the inn. I missed the inn stuff when I was looking at this before. I noticed it was there. I didn't realize what it did for me.
Yeah, if you remember from previous builds, you would always just get a pop-up like new family wants to join in.
Right, yeah.
And this is not going to happen until you have the inn, so they can come to your settlement, spend a couple nights in the tavern, and if they like the place and your reputation is good, they're going to be interested to join.
Okay. So quick rundown, I suppose we should say, for those of you new to the game. This is Colony Sim. We are medieval feudal times, I suppose. We are the lord of the land, not the king, but we're the lord of this plot of land. And we have some families that live here. We don't necessarily, like, we're not, we're managing. We're not forcing them around like you would think something like RimWorld or whatever. They kind of run their own lives. And they have their own economy within the game as well. And so, like, for instance, my families I have here in the game to start with, I have my family. I'm married to Anne here, and I have a child named Henry. But the important folks below me that work for me are my farmer family, which are the bachelors, the foraging family, and the fishing family. And so we'll put them out at, like, a plot of land for them to work, and they'll provide food and wood and whatever they do. And then we'll get like a percentage of that depending on what we choose, I suppose. Taxes and all that, you know? For the good of the kingdom and all that. And then they sort of do their own thing. Like, we'll plot out their place that they live and they work. But for the most part, they do their thing. They go out, if they need wood, they go get it. They buy it from me or whoever, or the woods people. And it's a very peaceful thing compared to most colony sims that certainly I have played in the past. Where there's a severe lack of cannibalism, I've noticed, and other atrocious things happening here in this. But for instance, we'll take, so this is my royal forest, which we're gonna put our foraging family in, which is the Corsis. So we say, this is your spot. Do what you want to do with it. And every season, I want you to give me 10% of the resources that you produce there and put it in my pocket. And this stuff on the side over here is my inventory, correct? And then each family will have their own inventory.
Yeah, this is one of the most unique features that we have in the game, the concept of personal ownership of every family. So you have to distinguish between what you own and what the families own. And if you want to get it from them, you have to tax them. Or you can just forcefully take it from them, but then they're not going to really like you if you do that too much. So you are always trading your reputation if you want to be an aggressive and forceful kind of ruler. And so, yeah, villagers do recognize what is their belongings and what belongs to the Lord, whereas in other management games, you might be used to that everything belongs to everybody and you're just sort of spending it on anyone's needs. In this game, you have to kind of transfer the resources between the individual families.
So, let me pop this. So put my farmers in here and set them down here as well. There we go. So I got my foresters or my foragers and then my farming family. Get them set up here. I noticed in the tutorial it doesn't mention much about getting any like walls up immediately. I guess it's not too much of a thing, but I noticed that with the seasons, with this newest update, I guess it's a much more important thing to get walls and roofs and everything set in time.
Yeah, that's one of the first things to cover is make the house finished before winter, because then cold temperature kicks in, and if they don't have a place to hide, you're in trouble.
Right. I only one question that it came up before in my videos, as well as already come up here, is about combat. and any sort of anything like that, any kind of aggressive things, or is there anything, any plans of something like that?
There will be some form of fights. Like, for example, if two villagers really dislike each other, eventually they will get into fist fight, which has a chance of ending with death, but that chance is relatively low. Most of the time, they're just going to faint and go back into their bed and recover from it. There's also wild animals who will be regularly attacking your domesticated animals, so you will need to protect yourself with guards that will be coming in the military update. And they eventually, so you're going to be fighting them. You already have hunters, which will be actively hunting down wild animals, and the wild animals will fight back. So that's the sort of combat that we're going for. We're not really focusing on grand scale battles or having raiders coming in, trying to ruin your settlement, and just sort of have this constant struggle, because I think the game shines the best when you focus on the management and building parts and just developing it and making sure that everything is taxed properly and that you know, the resources are distributed as they need to be and growing the wealth of everyone. And I think the combat just puts the focus on a little bit different direction that we don't like as much.
Yeah, one thing I think that I don't know if it's just me, but the first thing that I kind of thought whenever I got into this was it kind of felt like I was playing like a, almost like a Harvest Moon or like a Stardew Valley, except I was playing the town rather than just an individual.
Right, so yeah, just... that's a pretty good way to put it. I didn't think of it like that before, but yeah, I think it's a good description of what we're trying to do.
It seems really weird to think of it that way as a colony sim, but
yeah,
it just seemed like it fit well with what, once I got the town settled, you know, you had your farming family. You actually built the house and planned it out, and then just sort of, maybe it's the graphics as well. It kind of had that feel to it.
Yeah, to be honest, we used Stardew Valley as one of our core inspirations when building the art style. So, I hope it shows somewhere that there is some connection to, especially in the colors and how the different seasons are very distinct from each other, which is one of the strongest things about Stardew Valley art as well.
Yeah, I see it. So I have plots of land for everyone, and that's it so far. So I suppose I should probably get some things done here. Another thing I like is when we go to the spots, so for instance, the bachelor family over here, we're going to build a farmland. I got these mixed. The Corsi family is supposed to be on this one. I got these messed up. The Corsis.
You can rename them now if you want.
Rename the villagers?
Villagers and families as well.
I can say this is the Corsi farm. Is the name of my... that work? Oh, no. Maybe I didn't save it. Corsi farm. Huh? Did it work? Yeah, there it is. I see it. Yeah, there we go. Excellent. Okay, so yeah. So also I can click on the zone and it pops up what is necessary there. What I need in that spot rather than having to go through all the different things, which there's tons of different items we can put in here. Makes it much easier on me anyway.
Yeah. Sometimes some zones require a lot to build, which is a bit demanding with some zones, so we're trying to think of ways to simplify each zone as much as possible. But maybe that's also part of the game, in a sense that you just want to have a lot of things to build, you know.
Now, I know we have a public zone we can put down, and each house is asking for things like a well or a cooking table or a cauldron. Can we put all of that into a public space, sort of in the middle of town, and then deal with cooking things later on?
Yeah, you can place down a public zone, and some of the structures that are required in multiple zones. I think the public zone shows which of them are...
Yeah, the fireplace and a well and a bench. for just sitting around.
Yeah, so then they're just going to share it and you don't have to build it three times. So what I like to do is I build like a hub and then I build houses around it. So this way you sort of get this settlement kind of a setup.
Oh, yeah, but the houses like sort of grouped in the land they work elsewhere?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, exactly.
I gotcha.
This game heavily benefits from grouping households and having workplaces in different areas.
I know one of the...
Then you can put the working areas also closer together, so the trade is faster because they don't have to walk as far away, and logistics is really a big part of this game.
Yeah. I know you can put a workplace, a marketplace down. Is it wiser to put my... Because every family's going to have a shop, a storefront. Is it wiser to put the storefronts in central marketplace, or should I keep them separate at each of their zones?
I think it really depends on what you're trying to go for. If you would have like what we call ground resources, for example, wood or stone, anything that's generally very heavy to carry and wouldn't fit inside of a storefront, they're not going to be carrying it into the marketplace. What they're going to do is just they're going to sell a sort of a contract for those resources, and then the villagers will come inside of the foraging zone and they will just pick it up with that contract. So in those cases, you benefit much more from building the storefront inside of the zone because they have to go there anyway. But sometimes you might, for example, for food, you might benefit more from having a centralized marketplace, because then every farmer that's producing food will go to one place, which is like, let's say, three people. And then you have 15 other people who want to buy from them. So now that all happens in one place, which makes everything more efficient, and people don't have to travel as much. So you really have to think about the distances between what people are selling and what people are buying and how they can get it the fastest.
Yeah, I see. I discovered a trick to the swamp, and that is my farmers can't farm in the swamp.
Right. Yeah.
So the farmland is moving. So we'll do a little bit of that. We'll have a house over there and we'll have a farmland over here. One thing I noticed I did when I first started playing this, like a year ago, whatever, I put my farmers in separate plots, but I realize now that you don't have to do that. And I'll show that here in a second. I'll go and put my land down so we can get some tilling done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then I'll show this off here. So we can come in here to the priorities. And this can be an animal farm or a plant farm. And we can kind of mark what we want. So we say, well, I say, like, I guess potatoes, carrots. And this is like percentage. So for every two potatoes, we'll have one carrot, correct? I'm reading that right.
Not exactly. It's more about what's the percentage of the farming soil that's going to be planted with that particular crop. But each crop has different yields and different weights. If you move over the question mark, it's going to tell you more about each crop. So the actual math is a bit more complicated, but the game gives you all the information you need to work it out.
Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and put wheat in there, because so then whenever it hits summertime, they will just throw it in there kind of because it's on. But right now, because it's not available in wheat, because it's spring, they'll just skip it, right?
Yeah, they're not going to do it. They're going to treat it as if it would be zero, basically.
Okay. Of course, we get chickens and sheep and cattle in here. Okay, and then our farm is going to need some barrels, so we'll stick those over here. Like that. And then we'll put in some storage, I guess. We'll get at least one house started up here and get it working. So we'll try to deal with our farmers. Like I saw a question in there about multiplayer. Is there any plans for that?
Not right now. I'm not sure if, to be honest, if ever, because the game is primarily made as a single player experience. When we do think about multiplayer, the most interesting way of doing it would be some kind of shared nation kind of a thing, where different players have their plots and they can trade resources between each other, because we have like caravans in the game, and those caravans could be like player caravans who are selling goods to other players, because this game is heavily based around economy and trading resources between different people. So that's kind of a way of a multiplayer that makes the most sense for me. but it's also a really big feature that we don't have the space for, and it's nowhere in our roadmap right now, so I can't really say if it ever will happen. Yeah, that's just how we think about it right now.
Is there any plans for a sort of overworld kind of zoom out to other settlements type thing, or is it going to be just centered on this one town?
Not in the during early access or like for the full release. Things like that we might potentially think about as some form of DLC or post-release support content, but our roadmap goes and focuses primarily on the local experience of a single map and having a lot of stuff to do there and being able to develop a working functioning settlement where the trade works smoothly and you can do a lot of actions to exercise your rulership, basically, which is the part that's currently lacking the most.
I was wondering why I wasn't getting any wood, and I realized I didn't have a sawhorse for my wood choppers to get me some wood. We'll speed it up here so we can get some things moving. So for the inn, this is something that you mentioned that is, if I want to get new people, I have to have this. Should I do this now, and then should I assign a family to like two spots? So like my farmers will do farming and run the inn? Is that how that works?
That's possible. Not sure if it would be, depends on how many people you've got for the farmers, because that's also randomized. I'm not sure now how big the family is.
I have six people in here.
Yeah, so then that shouldn't really be an issue. If you don't build like too big of a farm, you can easily have them run both the tavern and the farm. I would then just make sure the tavern is close to the farm so they don't have to run in between too much.
Okay. One thing I know that came up before was I was getting families that didn't really do me any good. Like I think I had like a tanner come in early on. Mm-hmm. And yeah. I think I tried assigning them to like the fishing hut or something. Does that work? If they have no skill in a job, will they do it? Like if you get someone that you don't want, or should you just send them away?
Yeah, you can give them tannery, which is what tanners can do, mm-hmm. and then rely on the traveling salesman to bring the resources they need if you can't produce them yourself self-sufficiently. Like for example, tanners need leather or like hide. Mm-hmm. To turn it into leather, and if you don't have a lot of animals going on in the settlement and you don't have butcher to butcher them to get those hides, then the tanner might seem useless. But if you actually build the tannery, soon enough you will see caravans coming in, if you also have a caravan marketplace, and they will be selling those hides, so tanners can start doing work even if you get them early on.
Okay.
And then whatever leathers they produce, if you don't have a leather worker who would want to consume them, you just sell them back to the caravans for a profit as well. So you get this kind of import and export with the caravans. However, it's always better if you get a new family, if it's a family that you have an actual, like, current need for, like you have somebody else who can produce resources for them and it's more close to the chain that you are already developing, because they are more easily sustainable. So there is always a good idea to reject families and be smart about when are you gonna accept people. Like if you're gonna do it too fast, you might see some starvation going on because you have not been prepared for that many people, so that's part of learning the game.
Okay. Oops. I'm just trying to get some sort of settlement set up here, you know? Mm-hmm. Let's see if my farm's actually, well, something's happening here, but it's a long walk to get over there, so I see why having the house next to that would be a good idea. But they're also trying to work on building the house and plowing the fields. And now I just get a new job at the inn as well.
Yeah, they're going to prioritize differently. I think right now building is always prioritized over working. But sometimes they might not have the resources. I'm not sure if you've donated some wood to people.
I sold it. Maybe I should donate it.
Or be selling it. Yeah, that doesn't.
I
really
have it. So I still have some. Yeah, I still have some here being sold. I'll offer it free, right, just to get things moving.
Yeah, they have plenty of gold to start with. So
Okay.
That shouldn't be an issue. Oh, okay. It's just that they're gonna have to wait for each morning for one of your family members to go to the store, so they can actually buy it and pick it up. So that sometimes is slower than just donating.
Okay, I noticed the caravans. I don't think caravans were there last time I played. I think that's all new for me. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the caravans appear when you build a caravan marketplace, and then they show up every few days. And what we do is we look at the supply and demand of your whole settlement, and whatever you are lacking in the economy, they're going to be bringing it in from about 50% of their inventory will be stuff that they know you're going to be interested in buying, and the remaining 50% is more random to spice it up just in case. You would need something else that isn't really openly listed on the market. And then you can also purchase from them directly. So that's what was the caravans for in the book that you saw before.
Yeah. Okay. And there's Anne here. She's gone through some things. I think I got everything set up on jobs. I don't have, I do. I guess it's just going to take a little while. Let me speed it up here.
I think the house you have for the foragers will be a bit too small. I'm not sure.
This little one over here? Yeah.
If you can fit beds for five people in
there. Yeah, I do have five people in there. I was thinking there was only two there. You're right. Let's see here.
Yeah, and also when it comes to the professions and learning new ones, when they marry, they leave their original family and they're just going to join a new family.
Yeah.
And they're in that case, they will be able to learn that profession because they learn from each other. So you always need to have somebody in the family who has that profession so they can then perform the job. And if they do, then they will be able to also teach other family members. So in these cases, they will be able to actually learn a new profession.
Yeah. So if one of my foresters goes and marries a farmer, they'll have both skills.
Yeah. They start farming and eventually increase their farming skill.
Okay.
You gotta, yeah. Right. Experienced player.
Okay. We'll get him some beds in here. I probably need to get singles in here, don't I? Let's go like there.
I like the two dudes just chilling in the public zone. I think, isn't that the...
Oh, were they sitting on the bench?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was probably your ruling family. They usually don't have much to do.
Oh, yeah. That was slackers.
They're the rulers, you know, they watch over so nobody else is slacking.
That's right. Keep an eye on things. my farmers are too busy. I think is that fish coming in, or is that, oh no, they haven't built this thing yet. I need yarn for my fishing rod. Do I have any of that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you start.
Oh yeah, I do. Okay. They don't have any though. I have some.
Yeah.
But they don't have any, so I have to tell them to have some, don't I? So let's go to, where's my yarn at? Yarn, I'll grant 20 to the fishermen. So they should be good now, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if they also have wood rod, it should be good.
Oh, yep, and there she goes, and she's making it. Excellent. Now we have food coming in.
Yeah,
yeah, and you have plenty of food to survive about two seasons if you don't accept new families. That's how we balanced it, so... We
okay.
Give everyone about 30 in-game days to get things going. So if you start farming or like plowing the fields at the end of spring, I don't think we need to worry.
Okay, good. Yeah, because fields aren't going anywhere. But the inn isn't probably isn't a requirement until the next year, right? Until you start wanting to get more people in.
Yeah, it really depends on your... play style and your goals. If you want to grow fast, then you want to prioritize it. But if you're good with just few people, you are very self-sufficient right from the start, You can make food, you can make building materials, you don't really need new families if you're just happy with it. So it's pretty much optional in that case.
I have a good, stone paving. Let's do some of that. There we go. Yeah, whenever I played this before, both times I played this before, it really was more of a, instead of frantically trying to keep up with people getting murdered by whatever, it was more of a, just sort of like a creative kind of game, right? I was sitting back and just building the houses and drawing the diagrams. I was watching someone else playing this Obi something on YouTube, and they had a pretty good-sized town, and it was really cool looking because they had, I mean, it looked like you were playing like one of the farming sim games where you had they had designed everyone's house with rooms and the kitchens. It's really cool looking once it got developed.
Yeah, if I'm 100% honest, this game was built on the backs of frustration
from RimWorld,
because I'm the type of player who like focuses when I play RimWorld. I always focused on building the settlement and the kind of tower defense part of RimWorld, where I have to think of all these raiders and always prepare like barricades and wall myself off so it's harder to invade me. I always saw that as kind of like a fun challenge at first, but eventually it was more bothersome than fun for me personally. So I ended up just turning it off and focusing purely on the build mode. And when we started working on a game of our own, which is inspired in this genre, I felt like, okay, if this is a game I'm making, I want to make it fun for us as well, or primarily. And so let's just not do all of that stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, just kind of a peaceful, laid-back kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
I think my people are starving. I'm making more money or giving more food.
I mean, that's not to say that there is no cruelty in the game. Like, we're going to have execution sites added in one of the updates.
Okay.
And people will be causing criminal acts. Like, they're going to be stealing from each other. And in a very traditional medieval fashion, you will be executing people for their crimes.
I think I saw that question pop up about executions. Actually great. Medieval game.
Yeah.
It's not a friendly time. What kind of punishment and that kind of stuff are you planning on putting in there?
You can either exile people from the settlement, or you will put them in jail and let them sit there for how long you want, or you will execute them publicly on an execution display.
Okay.
So you're going to have an executioner profession, and they're going to be working in the execution zone and executing people that you decide should be executed.
Nice.
So there's cruelty involved. It's just not really... It sort of happens without you needing to prepare for it in advance or change your playstyle to, it's not a survival game. It's
right.
Like the cruelty is just part of a medieval life, but it's not the main thing.
Do we have a way of seeing like the social things
mm-hmm.
between people?
Yeah, that's a bit tricky because we don't want to reveal it for one reason. In the last or the release patch that we're going to be doing is planned a feature where you will be investigating families. So if you want to know this stuff, you're going to send an investigator who's going to follow people around, and then he's going to come up with a report. So they're going to tell you some high level idea of like, this family had a feud with this other family. Recently, they got into a loving relationship with somebody else, and like maybe some drama happened. And it's just going to give you some story kind of about the family. And this is because I try to keep it more immersive in this way. Like, you wouldn't necessarily know this information as a lord.
Right.
Unless you send somebody to, get that information and ask around in the settlement. I got inspired by some episodes of Game of Thrones when, I think it was Arya somewhere. They were looking for her, and it's like people asking around in the city, And I think that's like a very interesting point where you can just investigate and get this information and feel like really people have their own lives and you're their ruler, but you don't know everything and you don't necessarily directly control everything. So for this reason, I'm not revealing that information because, but at the same time, we're in early access and these features are coming one after another. So right now you're just sort of wondering like, are there any relationship? Is something happening? You don't really have a way to know. So that's a bit of an awkward position to be right now.
It's interesting. So you're, kind of gives you more of a feel of being a ruler rather than a god.
Yeah, exactly. There's already like, you know, this is very interesting conflict that I'm dealing with all the time. Because on one hand, I'm telling people this is about being a ruler. So we're trying to keep it authentic. But at the same time, you're placing their beds and walls and floors. And you're sort of like an architect, which isn't really, when you think about it, you know, your job should end the moment you place down the zones and villagers should just plan out their houses and everything should be automated. But that's a point where I'm thinking like, this is also a video game. Creativity is a big part of video games. At least I like that part of video games a lot. And I wanted to make that a strong part of this game as well. I think it's a very good reason why people come to play this game. So I felt like that's something where I don't really want to take that away just because it doesn't feel like something that a ruler would do. Yeah, these conflicts do come up sometimes. It's not always 100% consistent.
Yeah, how much do you want to put in the hands of the player rather than just letting the game play itself?
Yeah.
Yeah, I get it. So I've set up a chicken farm here. Do they scoop them up from the fields or do they spawn?
Yeah, not anymore. You got to build a caravan marketplace now.
Oh, okay. And then we got to buy them. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, let's get that. See what that's all about.
We had that in, like, I think in the demo version and in the launch version as well, because we didn't have caravans at the time. But and nobody seemed to question that wild chickens don't really exist, especially not like as a tameable, you know.
So I gotta find a place for. Oh, I'll do this. I'll squeeze it in here. And I like that it says. I noticed this before. I didn't see this before. This was the thing that I was missing when I first played before was the recommended size of buildings. That's very handy.
Yeah. It's a tough thing to figure out what's a good size to recommend because people like to build their houses differently. Some people like to really cram everything in as little space as possible. Some people like to give spacious areas. We're going sort of with a safe bet that if you built in this size, you're not gonna have to rebuild it, and you know
it's good though for
experience with the game.
Like once you've played the game, you got it figured out. But for the first time playing it, it's probably a good idea to have just some sort of guide to what you need.
Yeah, I think
more starving people here.
I think it's very frustrating if like people build their houses and only they learn that they need more and they have to start over and
right.
You know, rebuild everything. So
my fishermen. Oh, I wonder if I need to get some. Can they eat the fish raw, or do I need to have them? They need to cook it.
They will if they have to, but you preferably should build a kitchen so they can be making some meals.
And can I put this in the public area, or does every house going to need a kitchen?
If you have the inn, you can also just build cooking tables at the inn.
Oh, in the inn.
And
okay.
have them sell meals to everybody in the inn. Or you can build personal kitchens in every household, and then they're going to be cooking for themselves. And you can use the well as part of the cooking. But you can't really do like a public kitchen, like building all the like cauldron and cooking table. That's not really something that you would expect in a public zone.
Okay.
So. Oh, and the tavern is super tiny.
Yeah. I didn't notice. Yeah. I didn't see the recommended size until after I built the tavern. It's a tiny tavern today.
Yeah. Yeah, we, like the way it works, it we kind of look at how many bets in the tavern you have in the inn, and if there is enough, you will start to see some visitors coming in.
Okay.
So the inn should also have bets to have a place to sleep for tourism to happen.
So what you're saying is build it bigger.
Exactly. or just add another wing and build a bunch of bets there.
Yeah. I guess it doesn't have to be connected to it, does it? I mean, as long as it's in the same zone.
Exactly. Yeah. It could even be a second zone. You could have one in for food and one in for sleeping.
Oh, yeah. There we go. That'll hopefully help out a little bit. I'll just do this. And then we need beds. That's just wood and plank for that bed?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's also what this allows for is that you don't need to even build households for anyone. You can just have everybody sleeping at the inn.
Oh, okay. Like a big dormitory type setting. Okay.
Yeah. The variety of settings that you can come up with in this game, it's really something we try to push as much as possible.
Yeah. All right, let's go. There's the chicken tooltip. There's the caravan. Okay, caravans. Does someone need to run the caravan? Or is that me?
No, it just needs to exist.
Okay.
And have. Seems like we have what we need. So.
Okay.
We should see caravans in a couple of days.
Okay.
If I didn't miss anything.
Let me put some floors over here. Dirt floors for everyone. Okay, so and now that the tavern's set up, I should be getting visitors. And so you said they come in and they go to the inn first before they request, or do they request and then they go to the inn?
Yeah, they go to the inn, they buy beds every night, they buy some meals, and after a few days, they make a roll of if they want to stay here, which is influenced by your reputation. And if it's successful, they're going to ask to stay permanently and ask for a land to work on and live in, basically.
I think I may have given my farmers too much to do.
I think once they finish building the inn, it's gonna be completely fine. So
I hope so.
And you're doing decently well. It's start of summer.
I'll take decent.
The inn
That'll
is
do.
Nearly finished. So yeah.
Any disasters planned, like fires, floods, or plagues?
Not currently. It's definitely something that would appear at some point as a. Some kind of a post-release, maybe, if the game does well enough. But right now, we don't have it in the roadmap.
I noticed you had a plan for what next spring for release for full release.
Yes, somewhere around Q1 of next year. We have three more major patches planned out, and we do a major patch every 2 months roughly. So we've just released the major patch. The last major patch was released at. For Halloween, so that was 3 weeks ago roughly.
Mm-hmm.
So the new one should come somewhere by the beginning of next year, and then continuing from there.
Is there anything that I should put that what's the most important things to get in people's houses? I have beds, of course. Should I get a cooking table immediately, or should I just stick with like shelves and barrels and chests?
Yeah, it really depends on how much you want to utilize the inn for supplying food to people. I usually build the kitchen, some storage area for the ingredients, so shelves and barrel. Definitely don't miss a chest in every household, because that's how they can store their gold, which makes them more efficient when trying to buy stuff, because they can share the gold through the chest.
So here we have a brewer family wants to join me. I don't have a reason for brewers yet, but I could just have them just run the inn.
The inn could, either that exactly, or you will really appreciate maybe having some supply of beer for the inn, because people also like to drink beer, which makes them socialize. So I think it's a pretty good good luck to get big family of brewers, because they can both manage the inn and also make some beer at the same time, because they're big enough to do both.
So a caravan has arrived. How do I set up this? How do I trade with them?
Everybody's going to trade with them automatically, but if you want to purchase from them directly, you need to use the finance book.
Gotcha.
And there is a caravan step, and you can just list what you want to buy.
So the farmers will go buy chickens on their own if they're there?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, nice. Okay.
But I think right now they didn't come with any animals.
Yeah, I don't see any.
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool. All right. Oh, yeah, I just saw it go. Okay, I'm going to switch this spot over to be run by, not that one, to be run by the my new people. This will now be the Dial family. Six of them live in here. So they're going to run the inn, and they need to have their own house also, right?
Or they can live at the inn. That's also possible.
Oh, in the inn, they can live there? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
But that'll free up my farmers to actually get some things done. Yeah, I had that problem last time I played too. I'd get too much work to my farmers.
It's also a somewhat good idea to tax the inn more heavily, because they're going to be making a lot of money from selling the beds. Maybe not now, because right now you only have four of them. But...
yeah, I'm adding a few more in here.
Oh, and you have a dog there. You can pet him.
Oh, can I really pet a dog?
Yeah, you can just click on it, and it's very cute.
Where is it? This guy? Let me play here. There he is. Oh, and a deer. There you go. Belongs to the Bachelor family. Nice. Those are my farmers, right?
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Actually, we started with them.
Yeah. All kinds of excitement going on in there. I get paid. I get my share at the end of every season, right? So I've gotten one share of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, right, there it is. First day of the new season, time to pay your taxes.
Okay. Yeah, so now everybody rushes to your warehouse.
Run over here and dump it off.
What they owe you, yeah.
Okay.
And in the autumn, you probably know this already, you get the king coming in, requesting taxes from you. So you're just one cock in the chain. And it's going to give you tasks to work for the next year. So the king is kind of trying to push you to keep developing your settlement further.
Is there a place that I can put like a trash pile?
You mean like
you notice there's a pile of, like here, there's a trash pile right there.
Right. So.
Or is that just supplies that they don't have a place to put it yet? Because I didn't give them one.
Yeah, exactly. They make a trash pile if they don't have storage to store things that they want to be storing.
So ground storage. We'll just do this out here. You said chest for every house. Let me get a chest here. There's not a chest in this one. Here we go. Do that, and then there. And then, let's see. Holds barrels of beer and wine. So yeah, so okay, I get that now. So if I had set this up properly, then my brewers would have gone and just bought beer, because I think they had beer from the caravan. They would just do it all on their own and then sell it on their own at the tavern, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They will make a ton of money just making beer and selling it to visitors and villagers. So that's a perfect setup to have.
Yes, the other... Okay, so there's two questions that I'm guaranteed I will get on this video. And first one is Z-levels. Any Z-levels planned?
Mm-hmm. Not right now. I'm not sure if ever, to be honest. Because usually when I think about Z-levels, I think also about just making the map bigger. Because that... gives you more space to build, and you can also see things at the same time. And if you add Z levels, you're inevitably sort of hindering the performance, which forces you to make maps smaller. So it's kind of a trade-off between, are you going to make maps bigger or are you going to have Z levels in the game? And right now, I'm not sure if it would be actually more beneficial for the game to have Z levels rather than bigger maps. We are currently looking into ways to improve the performance so that we can have bigger maps, because we're already sort of on the edge of what the... As we are adding more and more content, the current size of the map isn't really enough. So we're going to be increasing that. And then putting Z levels on top of it as well might be a bit too difficult. But even if we could do it, I still think maybe just making the map even bigger would be more interesting to people. So, yeah, it's not a hard no, but I'm more leaning towards bigger maps if I have to make the choice.
The map's already bigger, isn't it? Because I don't remember it being this large, unless my memory's bad, which it certainly is.
Yeah, I'm not sure, actually, of what was in the demo version in the first version that you've played.
Yeah.
If we made it bigger since then, it's been a long time ago. But yeah, we definitely need it bigger, especially when we start adding clergy. You're going to be building churches and monasteries and cellars. Oh, yeah. And there's going to be, I think... If now it's like a very rough number, I would have to count it more specifically, but for until the full release, we're going to be adding about 10 or 20 new zones that are not in the game yet. So if you would want to have a settlement that's fully developed and has all of these things, you will just not have enough space. Especially with some zones which are meant to be really big, like the inn or the church.
Right. And there's a bunch of zones in here already that we'll have to get to eventually. The other big question I'm going to get, certainly on the channel, on the video, is about RimWorld. And, you know, there's plenty of mods you can do with RimWorld. You can play the medieval mod or whatever. And what would you say is, how would you answer that question? Why should I play this rather than a modded RimWorld?
I think the way I look at it is that this game is made from the ground up with a different idea. Where you have the families as a core unit, whereas in RimWorld, the core unit is always a specific NPC. Even though you can get to a large settlement where you have 50 colonists, it's not really the approach of what RimWorld is trying to take. Here you very quickly get to settlements with 40 or 50 people because you're getting new families with 5-6 people at a time. And those families are self-sufficient. The AI is trying to take away do a lot of stuff on their own. So you can actually have a working settlement where you don't have to micromanage 50 people at the same time. And I think this core difference makes that experience a lot more pleasurable than just modding RimWorld, if this is what you're looking for. And also mods, rarely find mods that have been developed for 3-4 years to create a consistent experience with unique art style and a lot of features in it that all work well together as one consistent experience. So you might get close to a lot of things and leverage a lot of things that RimWorld is already doing if you mod it, but I think if you want something more specific like this, then it's just not going to be the same. And whether or not it's better, that's a matter of personal taste, so I'm not going to tell anyone what they should like more. I just feel like we definitely are doing unique things.
Something that RimWorld for sure focuses on is like the dangers and the stakes. What do you have in here that would be comparable to that? Like what dangers do you have in here other than, I guess, like you have a seasonal thing, right? We have to make sure we prepare for the winter and farming for the winter. Is it a just sort of a weather threat?
Yeah.
Is that the issue?
Yeah, it's the cycle of the year is kind of the main rhythm of the game. You have to prepare stockpiling resources for winter. You have to fight the low temperatures, but also social class unrest. That's not currently very visible in the game, but we plan to have three major classes in the game. One is the peasant class, then you have the noble class, which you're part of as a ruling family, and then you're also going to have the clergy, which sort of operate as a medieval church, as you would expect in many ways. And these are kind of three main powers that are influencing each other. because noblemen don't want to hang out with peasants. Clergy is kind of in the background trying to influence people and change the reputation of you as a ruler. So these social dynamics also play. We plan to make them a big part of the game. So that's kind of the main form of unrest that you will have to be dealing with. And maybe also third thing is how harsh you want to be on people as a ruler. We give you a lot of flexibility between sort of like taxing everything and being very, greedy and trying to get as much as you can out of people. So you get very rich while everybody else is extremely struggling to survive. Or you're just going to be more lenient and you're going to let people keep what they produce and just sort of let the market figure it out. And that's kind of a spectrum where you can put yourself as a player, what kind of ruler you want to be. And if you will be a very tough ruler and very harsh on everybody, then you have to deal with the consequences, set up a lot of guards, make sure that people are afraid of you so you don't get uprisings. Or on the other hand, if you're very lenient and you let people do their stuff, you might not always be happy with what they're doing, or you might have a king coming in trying to request resources from you only to realize that you don't have those resources and you now have to start taxing everybody more because you don't really have a choice. Or you're gonna try and face the king and tell him like he's not gonna get what he wants. Maybe you're gonna get away with it. So that's the kind of an unrest that you're going to be dealing in Villeins and Villeins.
I suppose I didn't have either of my farm plots assigned to my farmers. So, whoops. I was like, why are my farmers not working? It makes perfect sense. They didn't own the land.
Mm.
I'm thinking, this stupid lord, what is he doing? well, another question here. Plans for sanitation or cleanliness?
Sanitation or cleanliness?
Yeah, like bathrooms or any sort
of... Oh, right.
We have a well, but any dealing with,
hygiene.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, didn't really think about this yet, to be honest. So the answer would be no. I'm not sure how we would deal with this. I thought about little things like having dedicated place where people do their thing, but they have so much to do and we have a very short time for each day, because we also want to make sure that when you play a map for, let's say, 20-30 hours, you're gonna see like 3-4 generations happening, so we gotta keep the days short in real time so that that can reasonably happen. And when villagers also need to work and trade and do all of that stuff, we don't really have that much space to have them do these, regular things that just take time traveling somewhere. Even if it takes just 10 minutes, it takes away from everything else. So we're just sort of ignoring those aspects of life and not focusing on them as much.
I think I've played, I don't remember what game it was. I remember playing one game like this that had a hygiene type system like that. And if I remember, it ended up just being tedious. It didn't really do anything other than just taking time out of the villager's day.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I would be afraid of.
It didn't really advance the game any. It just sort of was a needless thing that was in there.
Yeah. But having things like plague or sickness sweeping through the village is a very interesting thing that I'm thinking about a lot. Especially
going medieval.
Yeah, but it's the problem with that is like it's super punishing and you can't really do anything about it. But at the same time, it's very, it just nails the medieval theme of the game.
Right.
So I'm very hesitant to do it, but at the same time, I really like the idea of it.
Do you have any win condition planned?
No, not necessarily. Win condition, there is always a point where you will not really have further space to grow. You just sort of done everything, you have all the zones, or at least you don't have more space to build, and at that point it's very hard to keep coming up with new goals for yourself to be done, or like to keep playing. So at that point you probably just want to start a new map and try different things and switch things up. But there is currently nothing planned similar to like RimWorld has when you build a spaceship and fly off the planet or something like that.
Right.
Yeah. I was thinking about things like when you do a good job paying taxes for the king for like 20 years, he's going to give you a new title and then you don't have to pay taxes anymore or something. But I don't know. I don't feel like making a point where I just arbitrarily tell people like, this is the time where you're not allowed to play on this map anymore. You know, like they've built the thing. They should be the people who decide when it's the time to move on.
Yeah, that's kind of a difficult thing also for a game like this, because I personally don't play a colony sim to win. I just play until I'm done with it. You know, there's not really an end goal for most that I play.
So yeah,
I see that being a difficult thing to figure out.
Yeah, there might be some long-term goals that we're going to come up with, but none of them will be like, you know, time to move on from this map. I'm also thinking about something like a story mode where you have scenarios to play through, kind of like moving from land to land.
Yeah.
Similar to like a hospital games where you get a new hospital to manage and you get like, you start with a already somewhat developed settlement and you get goals to achieve there. But again, like those are just ideas right now, nothing concrete planned.
You mentioned like, we talked about executions and things before. Do you have like a jail or some sort of prison system planned?
Yeah, in the military update, we will be adding regiments, which is a defined sort of type of unit. You're going to decide what kind of gear they should be equipping, if they should have spears or warhammers, steel armor or leather armor, if they should be training to ride horses. And like, you just define your own type of unit, and then you're going to create a regiment, and you will say how many people should be in that regiment. And then you're going to build barracks and recruit people into military from your peasants. And they're going to train to sort of, they're going to first try to acquire all of that gear, and then they're going to train their fighting skills. And one of those regiments you can designate to be guards. So then you can set up guard posts, and they're going to be guarding the city and trying to catch any criminals that will be onto something bad. And if you do manage to catch them, they will throw them in jail, which will be another zone. And then once they are in the jail, you will have a UI where you will be managing all of your prisoners, and you will be making the sentences, how long they should stay there and if they should be executed or released.
What kind of units are you planning? Just like a guards type unit, like a man at arms?
Yes. Okay. That's like the type of unit is mostly up to the player, because the regiment is really where it gets defined, like unit in a sense of, you know, cavalry or spearmen or archers. Like you can have all of that if you decide that this is the type of equipment that you want this regiment to be wearing. Then yes, then they will become archers essentially. If you give them bow and armor, leather armor, for example. I should say here as well that the point isn't to, you know, wage wars or something. The military system is because the king will be requesting soldiers from you so that the king can go to the war, because that's part of your royal duties, to train an army for the king. So that's why you will have all of these, because the regiments will be something that the king asks you to. For example, in the next year, I want a regiment of spearmen to be ready to go to the war. So you have 1 year to train me 10 soldiers, and then you're going to be training them. And at the same time, some of those regiments you will designate to be guarding your own city.
And what happens if you don't do it? What's the king do to you?
It's going to be the same as right now if you don't pay taxes for the king. So the relationship will be damaged, and if you fail to do it multiple times in a row, you will lose the game, and the king will take the settlement from your hands, and it's being said that you are executed. So, because okay. Kings are not usually happy about disobeying their orders. So,
yeah, there's an idea for an end game. What about rebelling against the king as an end game goal?
Against the king himself,
and then being attacked by the king.
Yeah, that's an interest. Yeah, I've seen this thrown around as like when the relationship with the king is so bad, like instead of straight up game over, you will get a bunch of guards on the borders of the map trying to hunt you down.
Yeah.
And if you have like, and you could defend yourself if you have a lot of guards. That's an interesting idea. I haven't made any commitment towards this, so I can't really confirm anything in this way, but I can say I like that idea.
Yeah, I like that idea too.
We do have plans for like a local uprising though, so there is another game over condition. If villagers will be like too unhappy with you, they're just gonna grab pitchforks and all of the peasants in the settlement will go after you, and the guards will be sort of your last line of protection. So we do already plan something very close to that. You just replace peasants with king's guards and you get pretty much the same thing. So it's more of a question of what if you do manage to defend yourself, what would happen then? And that's something I'm not sure if we really have a solution for. So that's why I can't really say if that's something we can do.
Is my villager stuck over there? Is that what's going on? Yeah, I have junk just laying everywhere in this. My inn is terrible. Someone died in there. what a terrible place. Let me just move that.
Right.
There we go. Get them out of there. Okay. Such a peaceful game. People are dying off already.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very peaceful. You know.
Oh, did we hit fall? Oh, we're almost in fall. Nice.
Yeah.
Like our trees are changing colors.
Soon enough, King will come in with their requests.
Mash is asking about animal husbandry. So we've got chickens that are planned. I guess next time a caravan comes in with chickens, we should be set. But these guys should buy some now that I have it set up properly.
Yeah. Right now, there are problems with it. For example, the caravans don't... Oh, there's chickens there. I see a chicken. Did they already buy them?
Oh, are there some in here? It says 0 to 10.
On the caravan marketplace, I saw a kitchen running around.
There's a chicken right there. Belongs to the family of Mortimer.
That's probably one of the caravans.
Oh, yeah.
So they seem to be selling them right now, so let's hope it's not going to bug out and they're going to actually buy them. But to the question, there is, we don't have a system right now that would look into which animals they want to buy so it can happen faster. We try to tune how often caravans appear and things like that, but it doesn't seem to be enough. So we're also going to be adding some more clever systems which look into what kind of animals your settlement needs so they can appear faster. And the other problem is that the AI don't have the capacity to make smart decisions about... I think you need to move the wall one down because then they're not going to be able to walk there.
Which one?
In the that you just built, the hay walls.
Oh, they can walk on this bottom row here? I was trying to put a bedroom in there.
Yeah. Yeah, we're also extending the art of the beds because this happens way too often.
Okay.
People get confused that they're not actually taking the space.
I was trying to pretty it up a little bit. My houses are just hideous. This one's got kind of a bedroom going on over here and a kitchen, so we'll just look at this one.
Yeah. But yeah, so the husbandry doesn't really work right now because, for example, they just purchased the first animal that comes in, which if you're unlucky ends up being like 10 times female or 10 times male in a row, and so no husbandry will ever really happen.
Mm-hmm.
Or on the other hand, if you have a butcher and the butcher is purchasing old animals to butcher them, they're not going to care about if this is your last female or anything like that. So the procreation is there and it works, but the purchasing and butchering decisions don't really have any plan in mind that would optimize the husbandry. So right now, it doesn't really work as was intended, but we're going to be fixing that in the next patch.
Is there something that tells me how many animals I can fit in my spot here? So I have my field and I can mark, you know, I can put 50 chickens in here. Is there something that tells me how many they can survive in there, or is it just based on just as long as they got food, they're good?
Yeah, as long as they have food, they're good.
Okay.
Chickens especially, they can eat from the ground, so they don't really have a limitation. But otherwise, you can have at most 5 animals on a feeder. So 5 animals will be assigned to a feeder, and then they will eat from it. So if you want more, you just got to build more feeders.
No, the king is here. Okay, resources I'm obliged to give you. Okay, so I don't have any rice grain. I have everything else. Well, I don't have any planks for you. Okay. So how does the request work from the down below here?
The points you're going to receive when you have favor points, which you earn after another year when you actually pay these taxes that are requested. So then if you pay all of them, you're going to be rewarded 100 favor points, and then you can spend them on specific families. So if you are getting unlucky with the families coming in and you want some specific profession and you're going to see it here, you can just spend your favor points and you're going to get exactly what you need.
Gotcha. So I guess we have to get some grain.
You can think about it as like asking the king to send you someone from the city, from the capital.
So we should have grain coming in, right? Because I have the wheat. I know there's somewhere it shows what the straw to grain ratio is based on each plant. I don't remember where that is, though.
It's on the flailing spot structure in the recipes.
There it is. Okay. So if I get my one wheat will provide 3 grain. I need rice grain. Is that what he said he wanted? I think it's what he wanted.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay, so we'll throw rice in there.
Yeah, I mean, you have the whole year to figure it out, and the first year is usually not that complicated to achieve, so.
Yeah, someone's asking about temperature again, and I think we're about to find that temperature stuff, because I've got roofs on most of them, but they don't all have them closed in yet.
Yeah, I think one thing to check if we want to survive winter is if you have wooden blocks built in households. So they can be making firewood, and fireplaces everywhere, and also finishing those roofs, because otherwise the heat will not stay inside.
Right. I forgot firewood. It's over there.
Yeah.
And what about my poor family over here? These guys. They're kind of in bad shape. I'll throw one, maybe. I'm not sure they can fit around that, but we'll put one there and see if it works. And then, is it a fireplace in the house?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, the fireplace is for bigger rooms, and if you have a very small room, then you just want to build some candles, because otherwise you're going to overheat the space, and then they're going to be getting not really heat strokes, because they can just leave the room if it's too hot, but you might get some heat strokes if they are locked in or something happens.
Okay. Oh, yeah, I can see it here where the... Okay, candles are working. Let's put them in this... So this little house on the left here, the... I don't know whose that is. The Ludell, the fishing family?
Mm-hmm.
Just a candle would do that one?
Either like multiple candles or just one fireplace in the middle. Yeah.
We'll try candles and see how it works. And that one, I think, has a roof on it, doesn't it? Maybe not.
No, it's.
I may not have enough straw, or thatch.
Yes, yeah. Straw roofs are probably not the best one right now, because, I mean, you have 100, so. I'm not sure if you're selling it though.
That's 2. I think I am. Where's it at? Yeah, there's straw 117. I think I had it sold. No, I don't. I don't have any straw in there. All right, so we'll add that in. No more free things. So I can sell this. Is this either to the caravans or to the market?
It's both. It's setting a price, because if you want to sell to the caravans, will only purchase stuff that's under global value, global price.
So the pricing in our game changes based on local differences between supply and demand, and some forecasting in the future as well. And generally speaking, if you are not supplying things enough, then the price will go up. And if you're oversupplying them, then the price will go down. And if it drops below the global value, it will also make caravans interested in purchasing it. So if you want to make sure that it's being sold to caravans, nonetheless, you just click the caravans button and it's going to set the price that the caravans want to buy it for.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
That and then you can also specifically restrict if you want to be selling to caravans or just your local people.
So I have a corpse. I feel like we should do something about that. Do I have a? Is there a grave site?
Yes. Okay. You can build graves individually. There it is. We're going to be adding graveyard in the next major patch.
I'm going to throw her over here. Here we go. And then they should automatically put her in there once it's... No one has to own that. It's just a... Just a spot.
Yeah, the in owners will carry
okay.
Take care of it if it's, but it has to be inside of their zone.
Oh, the grave does.
Or you can just make a new zone over the graves.
Okay.
Like the ruling family generally builds everything that isn't covered by a zone, but they will not necessarily bury the people.
So just setting this up as their grave allows them to do that. Okay.
Yeah, this is following the basic principle that villagers are not allowed to use anything outside of their zones, because technically everything belongs to you, and if you don't give them permission to use it, it's against the law for them to just claim a spot as their grave. So this is why we just follow this rule, even with burying people.
Can I? Yeah, there's a bridge. Let's do a bridge. Let's do one this way also. Just to make one. There we go. All of the things out here, like the forgeable woods, that's all done by my foraging family, right? That's what they're doing in the woods over here.
Yeah.
And they're replanting as well. The Corsis. Mm-hmm. Can I adjust?
Oh, we have
yeah, I can adjust their stuff. Oh, hey, pigs.
We also have soil rotation now, so you got to pay attention to the quality of the soil. And if it gets depleted, you might want to restrict them.
No, I guess it's not any different. I see them. And then the farmers are still green, though.
Yeah, it takes about, I think, 2 years And also, the swamp is kind of nice because there's water everywhere. So a lot of the soil is boosted by that.
Oh, you know what? I think she died because I blocked her in there.
Oh, between the beds.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. Yeah, that's unfortunate. Oh, right. Also, beauty, yeah. Now, when you put decorations and more expensive furniture, then the whole space will be considered more beautiful.
Can I see a beauty quality on things? Like a flower pot or anything?
You can see it indirectly from the beauty overlay. If you build it, you're going to see how much it changes the color, and that's going to kind of tell you how much impactful the structure is. We currently do not display that information in the build menu. Maybe we could. I think that's actually a good idea to just add that information there. But different structures have different values of beauty, and they will impact the surroundings differently. So you want to do that especially for noble families in the future patch, because they will care about beauty a lot more. Peasants are kind of like, if you make them nice houses, they're going to appreciate it, but if you're not going to, they don't really expect it. So it's more an optional thing. but for the noble families, it's going to be very much required.
Here we go. See, that does anything for us. Not really. There's a flower in it. Doesn't do anything. It's still average.
Yeah, the flowers don't boost it as much. We're also going to be adding the most beautiful structures in the next patch, where we have artists who can make statues and paintings. And those deck and wind. You can also, you're going to be able to build windows. And these will boost the beauty a lot more. Also, you're not really have floors, I think.
I put that dirt, didn't I?
Yeah. Yeah, floor also increases beauty, like across the board, so.
Okay, we'll try that. I'll put it in my house first. I have a tree in my house. There we go. I think that's in my house, right? There's a tree there? Yeah, I have a tree behind my bed. They can't get to it because the tree and then the shelves. That's cool.
All right.
Nothing wrong with the tree in my house.
Yeah, it's a nice. Hey, it's your manor. You can have it the way you want.
They go, oh, are these pumpkins coming in? Oh yeah, I got lots of pumpkins coming in. Excellent.
Nice. Yeah, pumpkins were a very happy Halloween addition for us.
Yeah. I have a jack-o'-lantern here that needs to get done. She's still not getting picked up. I wonder if it's because they can't destroy this bed, maybe because they need to get to the side of it. Yeah, I built this place.
No, that should... Maybe.
I'll try removing this one.
But I feel like that should be not the case. You could try to remove the wall on the side, maybe when right now. Oh, yeah, right. No, yeah. That is how it works.
Yeah, that one got taken away. Maybe someone will come grab her now.
Yeah, they have to access it from the side to remove it, so you also got to remove the other bed.
She's stuck over here, isn't she? Because of this bed. Because they can't walk through here.
Yeah.
What a terrible inn.
Yeah, and I think we're getting some weird behavior here. She kept dropping the resources there, so that should not be happening.
I think because she is stuck over here also. Magdalene over here.
Because all right.
That bed was in the way.
Yeah.
But now now they can get everything cleaned up.
Yeah. How much trouble you get when you have beds that leave some empty space. it just becomes so confusing, the layout. So.
Yeah.
That's the sort of stuff why we have early access, to figure it out.
That's right. Yeah, that's what this has been yelling at me about forever. Storage insufficient. Where is that at? Oh, you guys have tons of storage outside here, but I guess it's all the wood they're getting in. Villager starving. Probably was her, wasn't it? Yep. Oh, animal's tamed. Here we go. We have. Nice. Hey, we have a pig.
Ooh.
Is he gonna find me truffles or something?
No, unfortunately.
What's he do? I noticed he was in the list for the forest. Does he?
What's he doing? Yeah. So the idea is that butchers generally don't want to like raise animals. They just wanna buy them and butcher them. Or just buy corpses straight up if it's from the hunters. So the foragers are responsible for raising the pigs. This is inspired by history. We kind of find out that a lot of the value of royal forests was in pigs being sort of living in that forest and, you know, feeding from acorns that were naturally in that forest. So they didn't have to spend extra food to feed them. And when the pigs would grow, they would just sell them to the butcher. So the same idea is here. We have the foragers who raise them in the forest from acorns that can be in the forest. Like you can plant acorn trees if they're not there. They're going to be producing acorns. And then when they fall on the ground, the pigs will eat them. And when they grow older, you're gonna just sell them to the butchers, And once we implement some animal husbandry and the breeding will work out as we want, then they should also reproduce and constantly be a source of something for the butchers.
If I put my marketplace in here,
mm-hmm.
will this be... I guess I asked about this before, and I said I didn't catch it. So if I do this, will my villagers use it? Will mm-hmm. everyone use it?
Everyone who doesn't have a private storefront.
Okay.
They always prioritize the private one, so...
Okay. Yeah, that should help in case I miss one, because I think I may have missed a couple.
Yeah, every family tries to have one storefront to sell, so you're not going to see two people selling at the same time for one family.
Mm-hmm.
And then they just pick either the private storefront, and if there isn't any, they're going to try to go and grab one in the marketplace.
I think I have, yeah, I got two pigs over there now.
And we're getting some cold temperatures now. I can see some guy getting heated by the fireplace.
Oh, roof yeah, yeah.
Not finished. I think we have a problem. This doesn't look good.
So it's a few of them. This one's not getting built. I think they just don't have any straw. I probably should give mm-hmm. them, they should probably have the wood one because they make the wood. So it
yeah,
makes sense
definitely.
That they would have.
Yeah. Wooden roof. Yeah, it's hard to keep up with everything, especially like, or like there's, it's easy to miss something and then you realize it's too late.
I'm also playing it a little fast. I wanted to get to winter here before we had to end it.
Yeah.
There we go.
That's them. Definitely a good idea.
Oh, and you didn't fill in that spot there. Let me give you. I'll give you.
Oh, there's a wall there. So.
I put that wall in there because they didn't. It was too far, I guess, for them.
Right.
There's also a hole on above my head while I sleep.
Yeah, we also added like a structure degradation, so villagers have to continuously repair them. It takes a while for them to break, so it's not that big of a. Demand for people, but they do have to do it.
Someone was asking earlier about dying from old age. Is that in the game?
Yes. Okay. Villagers generally live about 15 in-game years at maximum, and then they're gonna go to another world. So
is there a cap on household size, or are they gonna just keep going?
Not like hard cap, but technically speaking, or like natural cap, sort of. I'm trying to find a good way to describe it. Because, you know, the only way to grow a family is more children or marriage, so more partners come into that family. And both of these things take time. And the time also ends up making people older and die. So just like in real life, you're not going to see families of 20 people too often just because it takes about the same amount of time to multiply, let's say, as it ends up taking for them to start dying out of old age.
Yeah, we haven't had a birth yet. Hopefully. Well, I do have a roof on my house, so at least I'll survive. But
that's the most important thing.
Maybe exactly. No one else, but exactly. I'll be all right.
I mean, you can always attract new people, so, you know.
That's yeah, that's right.
How it goes.
Just get a whole new herd every season.
Problem solved. Who needs rooftops when you can just accept new families, right?
I'm really curious about seeing the punishment and that part of the game. I'm looking forward to mm-hmm. seeing that whenever it hits. That'll be interesting.
I think it's going to be interesting amounts of deaths.
Yep. Oh, I think we got a tree turning white. Here it comes. Yep, you can see the season moving in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like the gradual look of it rather than just all of a sudden everything hits.
Yeah.
Kind of a gradual sway of the season, and fall was like that as well.
We also have a music cue to go with it. So once the process begins, we play a special music.
I noticed the music change. I don't know if it's loud enough for the stream, but I did hear a switch over.
Yeah.
My warehouse here is just an open spot of land. Is that something I should be dealing with? Like, should I be making that into a place, or does it really matter? It's just a bunch of boxes, storage spots.
Yeah, it just looks ugly. I usually like to tidy it up. It's more organized. And also, one thing is, it's kind of tedious to always keep opening inventory space and to see what you have and things like that. Not necessarily for the warehouse, because you always see that on the left, but for other villagers. So making things organized makes it easier to just look what is in there. And crops should start dying off a little bit as well in the winter. At least.
Okay.
Yeah, it's going to take some time. They're not going to die immediately. And if you get extremely lucky, they will never die, because it's probability-based. But they are... You're not going to be able to harvest all of these.
Well, that rice is finally getting hauled into places, I think, is what's going on over there. Oh, and there's some flailing. So I should get some straw back here, I guess. Does it go into the family inventory first before... Because this is my inventory on the left side, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're clearly getting wheat and all that. But yeah. I don't get it until the beginning of the season.
Exactly, which is soon. So.
Oh, yeah. But we should be able to see, like, my farmers.
Or you can...
Family inventory.
You can just seize it directly from them if you need it earlier.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
It's just going to hurt your reputation if you do it.
Let's do that. Is it market? Is it at the market window? Warehouse window?
It's the finance.
Seeds.
Yeah.
So I want your pumpkins. And it's just immediate? Do I have to go over, someone goes over there and grabs it?
Yeah, they immediately have a goal to move the things to your storefront.
Their house.
And I guess I could do that if I needed to pay off the king. I could do it that way also, right? I could just pull it from there. Okay.
Yeah, right now the game is very easy on players regarding seizing. It doesn't punish in a big way. You're going to see a small dip in your reputation, but nothing too big, because it's kind of hard to balance the game for the final sort of version of the game, where other systems also come into play. So we're not trying to prioritize the overall balance of the game too much. We're sort of saving that for the full release patch. And so at this time, I'm just... to make sure that the game isn't going to be too punishing and kind of unplayable or, you know, frustrating to enjoy, frustrating to play, then the solution was just make the mechanic kind of not doing that much as we will want in the future.
Right. I'm going to see here, take a look at my... These guys, these are my innkeepers. They, I don't know, I have it set up for them making beer. I have beer. They don't have any beer.
Yeah,
They have a bar, but do they need something else in here to make, do I need them to have them? Because they're brewers, right? I should probably have a brewer zone for them.
Yeah, if you want to keep producing more beer, you got to make a brewer zone. And they're going to be planting hops on trellis and then using grains from the farmers to brew more beer.
Okay, I see.
And we got snow. Beautiful.
And no one has frozen to death yet.
Yeah, that's interesting.
People are starving.
Seems
but...
like... One problem after another.
But seems like, yeah, this works for now. They're going to be probably spending a lot of time by the fireplace trying to heat up regularly.
Does rice go into silos, right?
Yes.
And they just haven't moved yet.
The rice grain after they grain it, but before it's in the ground storage.
Oh, ground storage. Okay. That's one I don't... I think I've only got... Yeah, I have a couple of those.
Yeah, they will, right now they will not freeze if they've already been harvested, so that's not, you know, don't have to worry about that too much. They're working hard, considering it's winter.
Yeah, I probably got lucky having such a big farming family.
Because
when I played, when I played last time, I think I just had two farmers. And that was rough. Mm-hmm. It was rough trying to get food for everyone.
Yeah.
But there's six of them.
Yeah, you got six farmers, then six brewers almost immediately.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very lucky run. No hunters, though. That's a bit unfortunate.
Mm. So hunting area. I don't remember that one before. So when do you have the next update planned for, the clergy one?
We don't have a specific date yet, but we're usually spacing major updates 2 months apart. So I think the next one will arrive somewhere in January.
And do you have smaller updates planned along the way?
Not unless we're
gonna have to fix some crucial bugs or game breaking things. We are thinking about something small for the Advent. Some in-game Christmas things that can be nice.
Yeah.
So very minor thing alongside with some bug fixes that we've been identifying recently. But otherwise, we are small team, so we try to focus as much as of our efforts on doing bigger patches spaced out 2 months from each other than doing monthly releases of minor things, because that all adds up and it just takes away from the bigger features that I think are way more important for the game.
Yeah, and you said there's just two of you there now, right? Working on this?
Right now, yes. We have also Andrea in the team. She's working on the art, but most of the art for the game has been produced now, so that's slowed down. We also had Adambo, who did music, which has been finished. So right now, it's mostly me and Christian working on the game and implementing features and doing community management and marketing and production and everything that comes with making games. So it's a lot for a small team, but I think we're doing great.
Is the soundtrack available on Steam?
Not yet. We don't have specific plans for it yet, but we will definitely be looking for ways to publish it in the future.
Someone's asking about getting rid of unwanted families. That's not in the game yet, but it is a plan. Two updates from now, the military update, is that one that's coming in?
Military update latest. It might happen in the next update already. I cannot confirm that yet, but at the latest, it would be in the military update.
Yeah, if someone's causing problems, we can just kick them out.
Yeah.
Okay, I just looked at the time and realized we went a lot over what I was planning originally. So we probably should wrap this thing up. Is there anything else that you want to make sure we get mentioned here before we end this?
Yeah, I would definitely like to invite everybody to our Discord community. We have a system where you can request features and report bugs or just hang out with everyone. It's a very welcoming and supportive place where we all enjoy this game together. So I would love to see as many people as possible there. You can find the links on our website, lordsandvillains.com. I would also like to thank everyone for watching, and hopefully you've enjoyed what you see. If you don't have the game yet, I would like to encourage you to buy it if you like it, and tell all your friends so we get this thing going as far as we can, because we really love working on it and making it the best game we can, and having more people enjoying it with us is really why we are doing it.
I'll make sure and get that Discord link in my on the VOD below, as well as the Steam link. Thanks for hanging out. I've certainly enjoyed it. Any last questions, feel free to shout them out real quick and answer away. But I think I've made it through with one death only.
Wow. That's,
and that wasn't really my fault. It was the bed's fault, I'd like to point out. So
I have to say,
that's a record.
We should stream, end it now before anyone dies, because winter's hitting hard here.
Yeah. And of course, I also want to thank you for hosting the stream. It's been a lot of fun spending time with you. And so, yeah, thank you very much.
It's been a lot of fun. I as I mentioned at the beginning, I saw this really early on. I mean, I hang out in itch.io all the time, and so I saw it pop up, and I thought it looked interesting. And I have several times I've tried to play RimWorld or other similar ones with more of like a peaceful kind of a feel to it, and this one I think does it, where it's kind of a laid back. You're not worrying about raiders and the any sort of hostiles coming in to ruin your day. So I'm enjoying it. I'm looking forward to what new stuff is out there.
Nice. So
I'll certainly be keeping an eye on it.
Yeah, I'm happy to hear that.
Thanks for hanging out and chatting with us today.
My pleasure.
We got any question? Any plans for working animals, horse and cart, oxen, that sort of stuff?
Right. We will have horses in the game, and we are also currently implementing system for caravan carts. So the horses will be... the caravans that you saw right now, they just come like walking in the village.
Here they come right now.
But we're going to be adding like a caravan cart, which is dragged by a horse. And we're thinking of expanding the system with also a different type of cart, which would be a plow. And then villagers could deploy horses on farm fields. But that's currently ranked as nice to have. So I cannot promise it's going to happen. But it's something we would like to see if we have time to do it.
All right. Well, let's wrap this up. So anyway, thanks again for hanging out with us and showing us the game.
Thank you very much. Was a lot of fun.
Yep. Thanks for everyone hanging out and stream. This video will get posted here on the channel shortly. And if you have any other questions, feel free to ask. Leave them in the comments, and I will answer what I can. And we'll end it here. So thanks everyone for watching. Thanks, Michael, for hanging out with us here. And I'll see you all next time. Oh, yeah. I'll add a website as well.
Yeah. Bye. Thank you very much.